gotta admit, it's a heartbreaking sight to watch a seabird covered with sticky dark crude oil, probably dying.
My favorite. Peter Sellers, though, did something not many people know about. He put out four albums, record albums.
This is something from the other part of the world, our part of the world, New Orleans, in fact, the Dirty Dozen Brass Band from a crochet in a tune he wrote called The Back Where I Began. You're listening to CBC Radio. I'm Vicki Gabbro. Wax, pretty common stuff, isn't it? You have candles for the old dinner table. On your way to shine up your car, use a bit of wax. But an inventor named Willie Nelson has big plans for wax. He sees it as a lifesaver, actually, a potential way to protect us all from radiation and oil spills. Mr. Nelson lives in Perth, Ontario. That's near Ottawa, and that's where he is in the studio today. So would you say that you're a man obsessed with wax?
Yes, since the age of 12, thanks to the late Michael Faraday, who inspired me in wax. He wrote the book, The Chemical History of a Candle, and boy, did it turn me on, and I haven't stopped since.
Where did you get, like, in a library when you were a kid, you mean?
Yes.
Huh.
He perfected the candle that could consume the wax at the very same rate that it melted it. In other words, they had tapers in them days.
Yeah.
This is before Edison.
Right.
And in fact, one man, his name is Arnold Weave of Providence, Rhode Island, during Michael Faraday's time, dedicated 20 years of his life to perfecting a wick for the candle, for the future, for light, for mankind. And of course, Edison came along, then the light bulb, and there goes his 20 years.
Yes. Well, you must know the feeling in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But now, would that be a dripless candle?
That would be a dripless candle, yeah. A dripless candle is one that consumes the wax at the very same rate that it melts it. And of course, it has to be a formulated candle.
Yes. It's not just a...
Not just paraffin,
right.
No. It's a combination of paraffin and beeswax.
So when I buy a dripless candle, I'm buying something that is engineered.
You're buying something that is perfected and engineered, yes.
Right. And why is it more expensive? Because it involves another process?
Well, no. The reason why it's so expensive is because the contents are beeswax. And, of course, beeswax is very expensive. And in the old days... they used to make candles out of beef suet and tallow, mm-hmm. and they just dripped everywhere. And of course, when you add dyes to waxes, they help drip the candle. And if the candle's too large, it'll drip. If it's too small, it'll drip.
And if it's in a breeze, it'll drip, no matter how dripless it is.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
Do you know, I saw the most interesting thing only last night. I was at my girlfriend's house. She had two candles side by each in the same room on the top of a little shelf. And they were lighted, as my grandfather used to say, at exactly the same moment. And one burned like a hot damn and the other one went ordinarily. The other one was just gone in a half an hour.
That's because it was probably a low melt point wax. And of course, the heat would just fuse the wax so quickly. And depending on the ambient temperature or the room temperature, if the room is very warm and you have a low melt point wax, of course it'll melt and drip very fast.
But they were identical candles.
They were identical candles.
They were identical candles.
Was one colored and one wasn't colored?
No, both colored, both turquoise.
Well, were they close together?
They were about 3 inches apart.
Well, that's phenomenal, isn't it?
Isn't it? And you know what? I was thinking about you. I thought, I wish the wax man were here.
No.
So you can't forget. Maybe one was, the door was slightly ajar, and therefore the draft could have been hitting the first one.
Yes, exactly. Because, for example, if you walk by a candle, it will fluctuate that flame of that wick and
right.
fuse one side of the candle.
And let it just go like a terror.
Right. And once the dripping starts on one side of the candle, the fusion of the hot molten wax will just more or less cut the wax and then thereby burning very, very quickly.
So wax is your life, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It really, really is. And I wish I could live another 100 years so that I can just pursue my efforts with wax for pollution mainly.
Yeah, you have had a lot of clever ideas. One of them, you've sent me some equipment and we're going to do an experiment.
Mm-hmm.
The other one that I'm equally fascinated with is that you have petitioned not just the old USSR, the old Soviet Union,
mm-hmm.
But the Ukrainian government as it now stands.
Yes. Actually what happened was when I wrote my first letter to the USSR, the Ukraine was part of the USSR.
That's right, yeah.
It was USSR. And then I received an answer some weeks later saying that, sorry, we can't help you. You have copies of that letter.
I do.
And then, because we are now independent from the Ukraine, and of course there was no Ukraine embassy in Ottawa during that time. But then shortly thereafter, a Ukraine embassy was formed, and I was contacted a year and a half later, and that's telling me that our government is interested in your work.
And your work, we should say, before we press on any further, is that your idea is to seal the reactor at Chernobyl in wax.
Yes. Well, no, not no. People might take that literally. I did a grant for CMHC, Canada Mortgage and Housing, a few years ago, to show how wax could seal out the infiltration of radon gas. Of course, you know what radon gas is. It's a very deadly gas.
Yes.
And that's a cumulative poison that's an invisible, and people breathe it, and it causes cancer. I think everyone knows that. And so they picked three homes that had very high levels of radon gas. And so I made a claim saying that I could bring these levels down to almost nil. And of course, everyone had their doubts. And so they challenged me, and they picked three homes with these high levels, and I was able to mitigate these homes down to almost nil. And so this told me, he said, well, if I can keep prevent the infiltration of radon gas from entering into a structure by sealing cracks in the floor, service entries.
With wax.
And then, which I did, then there's no reason why I can't keep the escaping of plutonium dust from leaving a structure such as a sarcophagus.
Right.
So I would use the same application in the cracks in the walls, in the damaged walls of the sarcophagus of the reactor, and prevent the escapage of these plutonium dust particles from going into the air. And also I guess you know that the lid is on edge inside of the Chernobyl reactor, and it kind of, when it blew, it just flipped over on one side and is putting a lot of pressure on the cracked walls. And the only thing that's holding up this reactor lid is rusting pipes and reinforcement bars. And how they're suppressing the dust, I'm just surprised that they're using water to suppress the dust.
To keep the dust down.
And of course the dust, the air and the water are causing the oxidation of these reinforcement bars and the pipes.
So that lid is going to collapse.
Well, sure, because the pressure of the lid will be greater than the strength of the reinforcement bars.
Yes.
And the pipes that are holding it.
Because they'll rot.
Right. So if we put a wax tape around these pipes, we will prevent the infiltration of the air and the water, and it may not solve the problem, but it'll give them time, and time is what they're looking for.
Why don't they just do it, Willie? Why don't they just
Well, they don't
do
know
it?
They don't know about it.
Oh, but
they
you have, oh.
Yeah, they don't know about it until I told them.
Okay, but now they know.
Yeah, now that's why I got the invitation to go over there, because they're interested.
Well, when are you going?
I have a tentative date of February the 16th, providing I get the funds to get over there. That's the problem, is the funds.
Because they don't have any.
They don't have any. You know, they're using cotton masks to go into high levels of radiation dust, and it just breaks my heart to see that these people just giving their lives away to prevent another accident from happening. And so they're in more or less of a dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
And the lid is going to go down. They're expecting it to go down. It's just when. And when it does, the dust explosion will, instead of covering 20 countries, it may cover a third of the planet. And of course, the effects aren't felt until, you know, maybe 10, 15 years later. And the results are leukemia and thyroid cancer and lung cancer, and it affects the children mostly. They're most vulnerable to getting these kind of diseases.
Would you tell me I don't know, that maybe it was you that realized that, I think it's, you say 3 centimeters of wax will stop?
Okay.
Now, is that your idea?
No. Sir James Chadwick, who discovered the neutron, was a student of Rutherford, who discovered the atom, in 1932. Sir James Chadwick was kind of puzzled by some of the work that Madame Curie and Pierre Curie, who discovered radium, they were experimenting with waxes too, and they were just baffled by the ability of paraffin wax to moderate neutrons. So Sir James Chadwick, he bombarded everything he could with this neutron, and of course the slow neutron being more penetrable than the fast neutron. So, and I read I have a bunch of old textbooks, and by going backwards in history, I realized that, gee whiz, this man has discovered something for our future. And he's estimated that 3 inches of paraffin is equivalent to several feet of lead for moderating a neutron.
Right. What kind of a lab setup do you have?
I have a 16 by 22 feet concrete structure behind a car wash.
Ah.
And in there I have thousands of bottles with uranium mine tailings, pitch blend that I've crushed to create a dust in my... I have a little chamber that I create a dust. The reason why I had the chamber in the first place was to create a dust similar, that I tried to simulate the dust that's floating around inside of the sarcophagus in the Ukraine, in the reactor. And trying to figure out a way to mystify the wax so that it captures the dust particles while in flight.
Uh-huh.
I was able to do this, but then I was thinking, well, if the dust particles got too close to reactor number 4, where it's very, very hot, it might create an explosion because wax is flammable. Then I thought, well, there are fire retardants that you can add to wax. And fire retardants been used in wax that has been added to, like, say, asphalt shingles. You know, when a house burns, the shingles drip, but they don't burn.
Mm-hmm.
That's because
that's
because the wax has fire retardants in it. So fire retardants can be added to the waxes. Now, the wax
Isn't that interesting that the thing that we use to light up something, to produce fire, is also the thing that reduces it?
Yes.
Hmm. It's a work of art, this wax.
You know what excites me most is when the kids come over and say, can I have some of your wax to do my science study in school? I'm not doing too good in chemistry, and I thought if I did an independent study with using your materials, I might get a better grade. And boy, I just got stacks of letters from the schools, from kids from different schools, and they're all getting A's and 100%, and it's so rewarding. The kids are so receptive. And because I'm a simple person by nature, and I don't try to be too technical, and it's nice to be able to have kids come in and talk on their level, and I think that they're our future. And this, I think it's the children of today who will force the arm of the government tomorrow to use waxes, a very overlooked subject, untaught subject, for pollution for the future, because it's so relative to so many types of pollution, so many, many types of pollution.
Now, you have sent me a little kit here.
Yes, what we're going to do now is we're going to show, this is a preventative approach to an oil spill. And of course, you know what the aftermath of an oil spill is, devastation to shorelines.
Mm-hmm.
So if this powdered wax is put on an oil spill while at sea or approaching, say, a cove or a coast, upon contact, 4 seconds after this wax unites with the oil, it kind of polymerizes itself.
So it's sort of like that dry kitty litter stuff.
Yes, yes.
It turns the cat urine into this little block of something.
Yes.
And which can be just immediately picked up.
It can be,
is this what happens with this? I have my little experiment as if I were in the fourth grade. I love this.
Okay, let me give an example. Let's take the Shetland Island disaster.
Yeah.
Here are all these environmentalists standing on the coast waiting for this wind, which is blowing inward into the cove, blowing the oil onto a clean coastline. And, of course, the aftermath was the destruction of this coastline. Now, had they had something like crop dusters spraying hot wax over the oil, and 4 seconds after, it would be non-adhesive, non-sticky, birds could fly in it, fish can swim through it, and it would be no contamination to the shoreline at all. So this is a preventative approach to an oil spill.
Why don't they do it?
Tell me that.
Well, yeah, but they must. I mean, why the heck don't they? I'm having trouble getting the lid off the oil here. I've got some Alberta crude. But why? What is their reason for not doing it? I mean, well, obviously, if they can get their hands on this stuff, they don't have to get it from you.
You know, 1973 was my first actual experiment with the cleaning up of an oil spill in Passage Island in British Columbia. That's in Howe Sound. You're in that area.
Oh, yeah.
And Passage Island, of course, is a sanctuary for birds. And it was 2 weeks before the hatch, and there was only 2 low tides left in the year. And my wife and I just begged Environment Canada, let me try my method, the hot wax method. And they were paying a company called Clean Seas to just pack peat moss into the cracks and crevices of the rocks during low tide. And, of course, when the tide would come up, oil would redistribute
right.
all the time.
Yeah.
The reason is There are undercuts and hidden tide pools that you can't see or have no access to getting to this oil that's underneath the rocks, and that's why it constantly redistributed. Well, water being seeking its own level and oil seeking its own level on top of the water, well, I knew that by heating hot wax and pouring the hot wax in these coves and in these hidden tide pools...
You poured hot wax?
Yes, would seek the level of the oil and engulf the oil and fuse it into a solid. And while we worked 2 days and two nights, and there was no oil or wax to be found, not one bird lost its life. And this was done under contract. And the conditions were that we'll let you go try to clean up the island, only you have to pay for the materials to clean up the island. And I was so sure that it would work, I said, well, okay, we'll do it. So my wife and I borrowed $2,500 just for the wax. And, of course, all the labor was free. And we got a couple of rowboats and some oil drums. And we set the oil drums up on the island. And we built driftwood fires. And a lot of driftwood was saturated in oil. And that was great to heat the wax in the drums.
Yeah.
And we took the hot wax and just sprayed hot wax wherever we've seen oil and poured wax in holes where we couldn't see the oil, but we knew we could hear it underneath. And 2 days and two nights is all it took, and
you'd get the Order of Canada, for heaven's sakes.
Well, I think they put the reports in archives for 12 years, and no one, the environmentalists, never heard of the Passage Island cleanup using wax.
Nothing happens from this?
No response, no.
This seems ridiculous.
I get the odd call saying, oh, congratulations, and I hope that somebody does something about it someday. But I think my most responsive audience are children, not the people in the science field.
Okay, I've got 3 glasses of water here.
Okay, all I need is... You have a plastic cup I sent
you.
Yeah,
okay, thank you very much for my plastic cup.
Okay, now I have a bottle full of water. I'm going to pour my water into the...
Glass?
Into my glass cup.
Okay, so we're doing exactly the same.
Can you hear it?
Yep.
And I'm going to pour it in.
I've got half full.
Oh, no, pour it about a half inch from the top.
Okay.
Okay, mine is full.
My water is pouring very quietly. I don't know why that is, but I'll do.
You got to hold it up high to make it.
Be a drop. Okay, I'll do it again just for fun.
Okay.
Okay, here we go. I'll do it again.
Did you hear mine?
Yeah.
Okay.
How's that?
That sounds better.
All right.
Sounds more like water.
Yeah, okay.
Now,
instead of gin.
Okay, now.
Now, does it work on gin just as well? But it works on salt water as much as fresh water.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Any water, regardless of the temperature.
All right, now I've got my Alberta crude, which I have to tell you, we had to take the cork off with a wine bottle opener.
Oh, you did, yeah. I pressed it in good and tight.
It's helps.
Okay, now I have my oil. Now, gently pour some of the oil till slowly.
Like I'm pouring beer?
Very slowly until the surface is coated in crude oil.
Mm.
There it is. There. Mine's
black.
Okay, don't pour the whole bottle. Just coat the whole surface of the water.
Well,
with
the thing
black
about
oil.
It is, it's sort of covering the edges, but I think that it'll mush into the middle, won't it?
Oh yes. Okay, now
there's a circle in the center of clear water.
Oh, okay. Just pour a little bit more oil in. There. That should do it, eh?
Yeah, it's thick.
Okay.
I mean, it is like half an inch thick or something
on
there.
Okay, now what we're going to do is, because the wax and polymer, it's a mixture of wax and polymer that we're going to use.
I have two things of wax. I do.
Yeah.
I have 2A and something else.
That's to take home to your kids and let them play around with it in school. And they can,
my kids?
Yeah.
In school.
Sure, they can take it to their science class. And
They're as old as we are.
They are?
Yeah.
Well, they'll still be impressed.
The most remarkable thing has happened is that this oil has created a sort of donut effect in my glass.
Well, maybe we should put some more oil in.
Oh, do you think?
Sure, put some more oil in.
Oh, we want the whole top covered, do we?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, God, it's yucky.
Yeah, this is the most devastating. Oh, this is what kills animals.
Well, no kidding.
No.
It's revolting.
Now, did you see the Exxon Valdez on TV?
Yes.
Now, you know what's depressing is to see an animal covered in this oil.
Oh, it just kills
it. They spend 3 days and they spend $1,000 trying to get the oil off the animal, and the animal dies anyway.
Well, what about vacuuming? It would seem to me that you could just suck it right off the top here.
Yes, on the oil, yes.
Yeah.
Now, if we had an animal that was freshly coated in oil, we could do the same thing, put the powder on that animal, put them like a sea lion in this big box of powder, and we can just have 4 or 5 people fluff this powder on this animal.
Sort of like dry shampoo.
Yeah, so we can just vacuum, or you can actually blow it off with the pressure of air, or you could vacuum it off and let that animal go in a couple of hours because the oil ingests into the system
have
of the animal.
Have you tried that?
Well, I shouldn't say that over radio, but I know I have friend who is a beaver trapper, and he gave me a dead beaver one time, and I said, please let me experiment just on the tail. And so I dipped the tail in the oil, and I poured my powdered tail, and just blew it off with the air from my breath, and just blew the oil right off. So this is an indication
all
that
right.
It works very, very well.
Okay, now what am I doing here now?
Okay, now you have the wax in the little jar.
Yeah.
Okay, now I want you to start from the very edge of the glass, mm-hmm. and turn the glass as you sprinkle the powder on. You ready?
Yep.
Start sprinkling it on. Until you see that all the top is white with powder on top of the oil. Okay.
Well, I'm going slower than you are.
Okay, just pour a little faster.
I'm getting there.
Now, so you don't see anything shiny. There's nothing shiny at all.
On the whole top?
On the whole top, all the oil. Until you got nothing but powder on top.
Okay, I'm getting there. Just a minute. I'm a little cautious.
All mine's on.
Well, but you know what you're doing. So
okay.
This is the difference between the two of us.
Don't be afraid to put the powder on.
No. Uh-huh. Well, I just hold on now. I'm about half done here.
Okay. Mine's already on.
I know, but... Okay, but it does it penetrate right through
yes,
the layer?
Oh, yes, until the oil is saturated with the powder.
Mm-hmm.
Is it all saturated?
No.
Completely?
Wait a minute.
Not putting it on fast enough.
I know. Do you have to put it on fast?
Well, no, not necessarily.
Okay, the whole... it's now solid.
Okay, is it all white on top?
Well, it's thick white, too.
Okay, it's thick white. Okay, now count 4 seconds.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, now stick your finger on one side and pull the oil over to the side. Now, there's clean water. You can drink that water.
Oh, my God.
You can drink that water.
The water just comes right up over the top of it.
Yeah, stick your finger right through. Now, look in your hands. There's no oil.
No.
You can drink
powder.
That water. Just powder. You can just drink that water.
Now, okay, well, I might not. But
I have.
It's all, okay, fine. But it's all gone in a great, like, mud. Like, thick.
Like a rubber.
You're right.
Yes. In fact, if you want to take this and squeeze into a ball, say, in an hour... squeeze into a ball, tomorrow you can bounce this like a golf ball, and it floats.
It does. It's just all... it's amazing. Why did you have the Nobel bloody prize?
Oh, I don't think... I wouldn't want the Nobel Prize for something so simple. I think maybe if I could live another 50 years, I might work towards a Nobel Prize, but wax has been here long before man. In fact, wax has been here long before life.
Uh-huh.
And it's the wax that protects the plant life. Every living plant thing has wax in it. There's such an overabundance of wax. In fact, I feel wax is a common denominator for almost everything on this planet. It's so relative.
This is so extraordinary, as I look at it, that it's just, you could just scoop it up.
Oh, yes. And see how clean the water is?
I do.
Now, see, this is why, now imagine if it were on an animal, how fast that oil can be removed on an animal.
So where do you buy this powdered wax?
International Wax has been supplying me with the wax for free for the last 5 years for experimental purposes, and I've been making up little kits to send to schools, so you know, for science classes, and then it's in Custom Environment in Calgary has been sending me the polymer that I mix with the wax,
mm-hmm.
because if you have bulk quantities of just the wax in by itself, it would compact. So we needed something to mix with the wax to keep it from compacting. And of course, I would want something that is from the same origin of the wax, being of a petrol type.
Yeah.
It's a hydrocarbon.
Uh-huh.
And so I get this hydrocarbon polymer to mix with it so it keeps it compacting. And they're so compatible with each other. And this is why this happens. This is why it solidifies so fast. Now, the wax can be retrieved. You get the wax back.
Well, I was just going to ask you that. Okay, first of all, let's just start with the Shetland Islands thing.
Sure.
The most recent one that we've mm-hmm. got hit all the paper. All right, how much wax would you have needed to dump from the planes to clean it up?
Okay, we can work. My son and a few of his friends did a science fair 2 years ago in school, and I don't know how he did it, but he got a ratio of 13 to 1. In other words, one part wax solidified 13 parts of crude oil.
So that's not too bad. That's pretty good.
That's pretty good, I'd say.
Okay, so...
even if it was 5 to 1.
That even if it were 5 to 1,
yeah.
Right.
Even if it were 1 to 1. The thing is, how can you measure lives in dollars and cents?
Oh, well, and yes, and the shoreline, and people's livelihood, and the creatures,
yes,
and everything.
Yes, yes, and there's such an overabundance of wax. Now... the day Exxon happened, within the hour, I had sent a ream of faxes, confirmation.
Oh, I've seen some of them, yeah.
I went to, and I was ready to go there at my own cost just to do a section of beach or clean up a few animals real quick. And, of course, I didn't hear from them until months later, saying that, I'm sorry, we won't be needing your method.
Do you think that one of the reasons that they don't pay attention to you in the way they should is because you lack those credentials that would give you some sort of...
Yeah, well, I met one scientist at a uranium mine, and he couldn't wait to pull his cards out, and he had it wrapped in a rubber band to show me his card, and it said in big, bold letters, scientist, on the bottom. Well, if I were a scientist, I sure wouldn't have a calling card.
Saying I was one.
The same that big, bold letters, scientist. I'm not self-centered. I don't care about fame. I don't care about fortune. I care about solving the problems, and if I can't get through to the government and I can't force them to use it, by golly, the kids, and if I can get enough kits made to send to enough schools for science classes, because consistency is perfection, and as you've seen right here, this works, and it works.
I see that it works. In this context, I can't say that it doesn't, I mean, it worked, it looked like it works to me.
It works all the time, and then it's the children and it's society who will force the arm of the government.
You think that Greenpeace would be on you like a tent?
Greenpeace. Well, I know Greenpeace. I think they like to smash boats and they like to pick it and raise hell. I don't think though. I wish if half of those people would go out and try to investigate and research and try to solve the problem rather than protesting the problems. I think that we'd have a much better a solution for some of the problems that are facing the world today in pollution.
So let me give you the address for you, and I'll put it on my hotline, too. And I can't thank you enough for coming today. And it was a great experiment.
I wish we could do this again, because we can talk about wax till doomsday.
Well, I got your number, kid.
Oh, can I say one more thing?
No.
That the Chernobyl problem is a world's problem. It doesn't belong just to the Ukrainians, because if that lid goes down, instead of 20 countries, it may cover 40 or 50 countries. It's already touched down in California and parts of Canada. But it takes a long time for these particles to reach the surface. So it's a world's problem, and these people need help. We must help these people, because it's our problem, too. We're all the human race, and we got to work together.
Thanks, Mr. Nelson. Bye. Willie Nelson. He's from Perth, Ontario. He's an inventor and an expert, I would say, in all things made of wax. Willie Nelson's address, by the way, is easy. RR7, Perth, Ontario, K7H3C9. These are the cowboy junkies.